Okalama. Pea male. Rosu lima minute. Iona. Amatarole o tato samima. Mele tarsana tua ye lato umaele I. Yo mai e fa mava I a tatu. Yo lo mou pela na noa se ia. Tarte milea iona amatarole o tato samima. Amatarole tato samima. E ule to yesa va noa e to e. Fa mava e I a tatu. So fa mava I a da uma samima. Ia o Fadina le marfaro alo tele le marvo la fia. Tatete le temi le o to e mone. Tato proclama le mituna fa tete le.
Heavenly Father, this is one of those times when we really don't know what to say and what to do. And so we leave everything into your hands. We pray for the presence of the Holy Spirit, so that He, as you have said in Romans chapter 8, can intercede in behalf of us with groans that words cannot express. Because, Lord, we, in times like this, don't know how to pray and what to pray for. But, Lord, we believe in you and we trust in you, because you are in control in spite of this sinful world and all its events. So bless our program today as we celebrate Anthony's life, his dedication to you and his love for Jesus. And as we pray for the time when we will see you again, in Jesus' name.
Mau po e oti ai. Ona poem toai, ma ona po, e ia e eini mea o toina. E moni, e siri ona lei, o le alu fale vano noa. I le alu fale o iai tom sa minga. O wā o e unga lea, o tana taunga. Ma e mana tua fōi I le loto o tana te sui fōi. Sa nei, e ui na le so lama le lei I sui fōi. E ui lawa I le whawa tu ia o tātou sā. A le whaftai, lo iei le tua lo sirfia. Ia tonga lunga ma kipolenga. O aia te tele ma aia whanau loa. Tā leo te ofalo whāko ai pa io ai na lua. Tū te tele mai tū te ulangi. A inga tau tupu me. Pali tua me tau si. Ta mali I me fai la uma. Le au manga sao ao. Se I o lama I liu ta mai tai. Ma nai e tātou whanau mai. Pa whiwa I whakto atu, ma whatalo whakto atu. Ma aves ese man pia las O e u whai o nasi si mai. E mori mo wina ni tue tei mi reatri. O to e sea o ma nava na ngā luena. Pa taro whakto no whai ngā luena tofi le tua. E ngā te reu whatalo whakto atu. Ia te oere tina mano lo, man malo. Whenei ngā taulangi o tū aina, tau tū. Whātā rofam whawhelo ai whātua. Mā te watu o tātou whātasi fōa. Mā le whaipule mai ngāna mau mai Samoa. E watu le lima mā fōla e whātā rofam whātua tuai. Malor soifua. There is a time for everything. And a season for every activity under heaven. Time to be born. The time to die. Time to plant and time to uproot. Yes, indeed. It is better to go to the house of mourning. Than to go to the house of feast. For death is the destiny of every man. The living should take this to heart. This morning, I always feel responsible. I feel obligated. Especially in this occasion. To convey and express my sincere sympathies and condolences, especially to our bereaved family, for the parting of our brother, our son, even though it's very hard to accept, but God knows the past, the present, and in the future. There are things of life that we never comprehend because it is beyond our comprehension. And we do believe that there is such a God who knows the past, the present, even in the future. I want to extend a warmth and hearty welcome to both sides. Distinguished guests, visitors from near and far. I want to recognize the Faletua Tina Malolo Man Malo. And as a matter of fact, we are here from the member of the parliament from American Samoa. Greetings to you all. We are here with our fellow ministers, from different churches here in our Bay Area. And on my right side, I'm glad that we are here with the director of Asian Pacific of Central California Conference, Daniel Orbar. Next is Pastor Fraser. He's the pastor of Mountain View Central Church. And it is my privilege also to welcome him to our meeting. On my left side, I would like to introduce my friend, David Hadji. He's the current pastor of East Palo Alto Church. All these pastors, they know Tatupu very well.
Amen. Amen.
They even call me, Pastor, we want to be there.
Amen.
We don't want to miss, we want to be present. We want to see him before his burial. On the behalf of this church, fellow ministers, thank you. I feel comfortable when I see you coming. I want to praise the name of the Lord. You are here for the reason to mourn together with our mournful family. Once again, thank you all for your coming. Le pese o i lumo le tato vie. E le tu mau leona nei. Shall we all stand and sing together?
Oh, Heavenly Father, we come here this morning to celebrate a life well lived, but nonetheless too short lived. Father, this morning a soldier for Christ have fallen. Lord, this morning someone very special and near to my heart is resting. But Lord, this morning as we celebrate, Lord, the counsel of Paul is not to celebrate as those without hope. But Lord, we have that great hope that burns in our hearts. That when the trumpet sound, when Jesus bursts forth through the clouds, that Anthony will rise to meet the Lord in the air with many of us. So Father, this morning, Lord, we want to comfort the family, the church family that is grieving and moaning because someone so special have left them. The biological family and extended family, Lord, they're missing someone that they love, someone with a great big heart who knew how to love as well. Father, this morning, Lord, I'm here, and Lord, all our hearts are broken this morning. And Lord, we come to you because you're the only one who knows how to put the pieces back together again. And Lord, this morning we come and we call on the name of Jesus. For there is no other name to soothe us with your healing balm, to take our thoughts, to take the pain that we feel within our hearts. And Lord, draw us to that place where you live so we can experience your joy. Lord, so that we can say that weeping might endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. We can say like John the Beloved, that we look for that city, New Jerusalem, oh, where Jesus lives and dwells. And Lord, we look for that day when you will wipe away all tears from our eyes, where there'll be no more sorrow, no more weeping, no more death. Oh God, this is painful. And we come to you this morning because you would have to help us through this. It's hard for us to take. We're hurting inside. But Jesus, we know that you're able to do what only you can do. So Lord, in advance, we give you the praise. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. We thank you, Lord, for healing our woundedness, for healing our broken heart, for soothing our pain. Lord, this morning I lift up mom, I lift up dad, I lift up sister, brothers, Lord, oh God, they're hurting.
Yes.
And Lord, they need you this morning. We need you. They need us. So Father, help us, oh God, to open our arms and embrace this family with love. And Lord Jesus, I thank you so much. When Jesus comes, Jesus, who is the great equalizer, he will make all things well again. So until then, Lord Jesus, go with us, help us, bless us, give us strength, Lord. Take our thoughts, take our minds, oh God, and just, oh Lord, do what only you can do. Help us, we need you, Lord Jesus. We praise you and we thank you, Lord, for Anthony. The blessing he was to this church. The blessing he was to the youth of this church. The blessing he was, Lord, to the music ministry of this church. The blessing that he was, Lord, to camp meeting, to our conference, Lord. We're going to miss that young man. But we thank you, Lord, this morning we can say that this was a young man who loved God. This was a young man who knew in whom he believed. And Lord, even though he's been snatched away by the cold hands of death, nonetheless we know, God, that your Holy Spirit was with him. We know, Lord, that his guardian angel was with him. And Lord, we know, God, that Lord, you will mark that spot on judgment morning. when Jesus shall step forth on the clouds of glory to call Anthony to that home where he will live with Jesus forever. And Lord, may we who are alive be faithful to your church, be faithful to your work, be faithful to you, so that when we too will be snatched by death, Lord, we will be ready. Oh Lord, help us this morning. If there is anything we can take from this, it's to be ready. Stay ready. Jesus is coming. Lord, we praise you and we thank you in your precious and holy name. And all of God's people said, amen.
Our Old Testament scripture for this morning is coming from the 23rd Psalm. I'm reading from the New International Version. The Word of God says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a place before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Our New Testament reading is coming from the book of Revelation, the 21st chapter. And God says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the first earth and the first heaven were passed away. There was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, family, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away.'" May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, the doing, and the believing of his word.
Solo maltato voi pese lunga yi asi pese mai poka la titi lea ya tau de ago mer falo algo fa talo fa tuai de sunga te tai ya pese lupa yi o leo fenga luena te ngani fuori tatu saunino ele tue tele se matu fam talanga matu fa pe atu. So we are in the valley of Satu Yama, you two, Pinangalo, Yamisipo, I in the day, not going at the Nang here in the Yasu. I am honored and privileged to welcome our Pastor Munwa and other pastors that are here, and especially every one of us that are present here today. This song we're about to sing is a song we call it in Samoan or Pesipa Mavai, and we need to say goodbye to Tatupu. But I just want to share with you this young man. Every time I come here in this church to watch him and watch whatever concert they're doing together, every time he finishes, he walks straight up to me and the first question is, did I do good, Uncle? He always checks out with me, and he always, I said, I can see you're very nervous in the beginning. Because as soon as I see you, I cannot even think straight anymore. Because, you know, I took it to the level that I can take to as far as I can. Now it is your responsibility to take it even higher. And then the next one comes and take it even higher and higher.
Amen.
Well, he's gone higher now for me. This song, three parts, is a medley. The first part is we're asking God's Holy Spirit to comfort all of us. And then the second song was written long, long time ago. You will recognize the tune, but the words will be a little different. It's a song written by a guy to his girlfriend when he passed away. Those lovely words. And then the last song, when a sailor was going to depart with the warship of America, coming back here, he fell in love with a Samoan girl, but she couldn't come. You know, we need visas to come here those days. So she stayed back, and he wrote this song. And you will notice, you will recognize the tune. So we're going to sing it for Tatupu and all of us today. Please enjoy.
Thank you.
Attempt to summarize my brother's life, and even in his 22 years, so short, there are far too many memories to relate to you this morning, so I'll try to just pick out the fun ones. And one in particular that many in our family and our church always remember, there was an afternoon where Tatupu was playing on the Sabbath, he was playing with all the other
children of this generation, and they are picking teams. And they start to split each other into teams. And Tupu is the last. And they begin to push him. Tupu, what team are you on? You have to pick a team. And we're all sitting there on those steps outside. We're all looking at him. He turns and he says, I'm Tatupu. I'm a one-man team. He was only six or seven. And that's how I always knew him. One-man team with one cheerleader. Anthony Tatupu Tuaumu-Vaili was born in the early evening, October 9th, 1992, in Haywood, California. At the time, we were living in Oakland. And I always remember I told this story on Sabbath afternoon at our memorial service. I asked for a brother, and I asked my parents for a brother because I was so awkward, and asked everyone who knew me as a child. My head has always been pretty much the same size. My body just kind of got fat to balance my head. And so, you know, I was very awkward and alone, not very talkative person, and so I need a friend. So I asked my parents to give me a brother. And like I shared with our church family and all those who were here for the memorial on Sabbath, after a few months, I asked my mother to take this brother back. Say, exchange. Ever since Tupu could crawl, he could race. And he would always race me. And he would cry if I didn't race him. Because that's how he always was, always had that kind of spirit of trying to be better, even when he was a baby. I have a fond memory, or my family has a fond memory, not so fond for me, but fond for them because we would always race up and down the hallway, and I would always let him win, because of course he was, you know, he can't even walk. But one time I did beat him, crawling, and I was just kind of standing there laughing at him, and then I felt this sharp pain in my backside, and it was Tupu biting me. And he had about two teeth. Got a fire, the teeth was coming in. But by the time we moved around in the East Bay a lot, and as he continued to go to school, he started school, elementary school, in various cities in the Bay Area, in Haywood, Union City, and in San Leandro and San Lorenzo. Another good memory that I have of Tupu is that we used to call him our little puppy because he was a horrible, messy eater. And he would just leave his food all over the place and he only liked one thing, and that was mac and cheese. We would have mamoy, we would have bulgogi, we would have everything, but no, he wants blue box, macaroni and cheese. And he wants me to make it for him because he just wants my life to be miserable. So, I would always make it for him and maybe I put a few extra ingredients in there just to play with it. He would always come and he would drag on my leg and he would say, blue box, blue box. So I would make it for him. But it was so messy that my parents resorted to having him eat on the floor because he was so messy. So we would leave a blanket out for him. And he wouldn't eat unless Florence would come and eat with him. So he just kind of sit there and watch, and then she would have to come and take her plate on the floor, and so she did. On the floor. When he started to go to school, you know, myself and my sister, we love school. Learning and books is something that my mom always, you know, forced upon us. But it's something that we came to love over time, you know, being raised by a former teacher. Tupu was different, and he always asked him, what do you like the most about school? You like math, you like academics? And he goes, I like lunch and recess. And that's kind of always how he was. He played and he could never stay inside. You couldn't keep him inside. He always wanted to be inside, even when he was wearing his diapers. He also liked to be outside of his clothes a lot. We had a hard time keeping his clothes on. He was always running around. He was always playful, always joyful. Probably the happiest boy that I ever knew. I called him Bad Baby so much. I think he thought that his name was Bad Baby. I would call him Tatupu. And he would just kind of stare and say, "Bad baby." That was his name. By the age of 9, we had settled in Berkeley. I don't know if any of his school friends are with us, but he loved them. That was his kind of place, very diverse, different kinds of people. His stomping grounds and where all these miscellaneous Kenyans that people keep on talking about were from. But he went to school there for elementary school and eventually graduated there. When he was 10, I forced him to learn how to play the trombone. And I did force him because if any of our church members will remember all those really kind of pitchy special musics from all those many Sabbaths, I forced him to play the trombone because I always thought that he's just playing around and he's not good at anything, so he must be good at something, so I'm going to force music onto him. But he came to love it. I taught him a lot of things, as is the case with many Polynesian and Samoan families. We are not rich, and so our parents must work. And my parents have certainly worked very hard multiple times their whole life. And so many things, especially since I was 5 years older than him, I had to teach him. I taught him how to ride a bike, and I taught him how to throw a football. If that's surprising to you, because I don't know how to play football. I taught him how to cut his hair, and I taught him how to love suits. And he ended up being better at me than all those things. It's stressful to be an older brother to a younger brother who's always better at you than so many things. But as he came into his own in our music and our growing together, he became my right hand in everything, especially when I got sick. And when I was first diagnosed, the doctors didn't give me much time at that time, back in 2006. So I told him, "You have to be ready in case I go." And it was kind of around that time I had these keys. I don't know, you guys always see him carrying around those keys with the neck. Those are actually my keys. Those are my keys. But he was walking around with them because I had to be in the hospital. And I gave him the keys, keys to the church and all this stuff. I told him to look at the PA and watch out for all the pastors and serve their food and take their place.
Amen.
And when I was too sick to do any of those things, he took over for me. And when I came back, I said, "Okay, time to give me my keys back." But he never did. He never did give me my keys back. And even those things, he began to become much better at me. Just a few things before I close this testimony, just so that you get a nice round picture of him. Our sister Lee shared with us how when she came from Samoa, she in fact was another mother to him, and she did spoil him. And one of the things about Tuku is that he liked to be spoiled. In fact, on my birthday, he gets two gifts and I get one. Another thing about Tuku, we have this inside joke because he watches movies. The boy can just watch movie after movie after movie after movie, and his eyes still hurt, he just watches movies. And I kind of have a fondness for movies as well. But we always pay attention to the soundtracks, and I'm kind of, I'm a little bit hesitant to share this with the church, but a lot of times when I play music on the piano or the organ, I'm playing soundtracks from a movie. And me and him, we know the soundtracks from the movies. And every time I'll play it, he'll give me this look like, ah. One particular soundtrack that he likes is the dramatic ending to the movie, Cool Runnings. So listen for that, because I play it a lot. Every time I was ready, he would always turn to me like, yeah. Other fond memories that I have of Tuku that show his character and his love of life and his love for people is such as Tina and Manolo shared with us yesterday during our service how he would always fix her food and tend to all of her needs. What Tina did not mention is that Tina does not speak English and Tuku does not speak Samoan. So it was a very interesting for them to sit together. And you know, there's the Tinawa talk, and he's like, what? He, I'm so she was like, oh, and then she was like, what did I talk to you about? I don't know. You know, more time or lunch time, but he was always faithful that way. Another fond memory, so many fond memories, I'll cut it short. But my dad always did this to him when he was a baby, and he kept on doing it to him even when he was grown. He would always sing, I think it's a Prince song, and he would say, could you be the most beautiful boy in the world? And he would always sing it to him, and he'd be like, Dad, that's a girl song! I'm pretty sure he knows he's a Lord provider, but you would always see that song too. Tubu graduated from Berkeley High in 2010. And because he's always copying me, he did give the main speech for the graduation.
Amen.
During that time, I had a second transplant. And fortunately enough, I was able to go to the graduation, but I had to stay in the hospital and I couldn't leave for about 10-mile radius for a couple months. And so I noticed him hanging around a lot. And I said, shouldn't you be going to, you know, college for now? And he said, no. I was like, I want to stay with you. He said, okay, then come and blow me my feet. And he would blow me my this, and he would have his phone. Then I kicked him out of the room because he's the worst blow-me-er of all time. My mom likes it, but it's like being blown by a spike. It's like sharp, tiny fingers, needles. But that was the kind of boy that he was. He put all his plans on hold for me. He stayed to take care of me. And never gave me back my keys. He had a way with children always. Much like the Reverend Tapoy. He could attract children. He always made friends with so many people. I'm also hesitant to show this, or to tell this, but since he's gone and can't get mad at me, I'll share it with you anyway. As young people do, they get involved in relationships. And he was in a few relationships of his own. One in particular, no fault on any part. It broke him, it changed him. I noticed this because, you know, he was in the hospital with me. And, you know, he became more reserved, and he had a wit. He always talked. And so he hid behind his wit and his strength because he was a strong boy. And he could, you know, always fight back at your insults. But I could tell, you know, something had changed. He was not open and he was not talking. And at that time, around 2008, my sister and my brother were in the hospital with me, and I had an allergic reaction to a drug, and most people die from this. So they told me before, and I signed the form, that if I have the reaction, that, you know, they're not liable, because, you know, hospital. And I began to have the reaction, and I told Tupu, he held my hand like this, and I began to shake, and they took him out of the room, and I remember looking at him, and thinking, I'm never going to see him again. And when I sat in that hospital, and they brought the crash cart, and they were able to revive me, and I was saved for the second time. I asked the Lord why he saved me. Why did he let me go then? And there were times where I thought I should have gone, because it was very painful. But I know now that the Lord preserved me so that I could spend more time with my brother. And I made a promise to the Lord. We made a promise to the Lord that if he saved my life, that we would give everything to his service.
Amen.
We did. And some very important people came into our life, and I just want to mention them. We began to have meetings, and woman and her daughters came into the church. And my father came and introduced, said, this is my cousin, Reed. And this is her daughter, Emma. And we began to become close to them. And she became like a sister to us. And then there came others. My father's cousin, Pua, and his daughters, Lia and Melody, and Myra, the father boys, Sheo Turin, all these young people, so many of you young people, which I could spend the whole day mentioning all of you. But you changed to who he was able to love again because of his love for these children. I'm not a person who grows easily close to anyone. Our sister, Lily, who lived with us basically for most of my life, I could never even call her sister until about a few years ago, because that's just kind of the person I am, very reserved and very... But Tuba was not that way. He loved like Jesus loved. And when you were his sister or his brother, you were, as the Samoan people say, koko maivi maa. You were flesh and blood, bound for life. And that's how he always was. That's how he loved. And I'm so thankful to these young children for being able to open my brother's heart and help to heal his wounds from not only his relationships, but his own foolish decisions, which none of you really know about. You're not going to learn it from me, sir. That's why in the back you see that there's this long list of siblings. This can go on and on and on. If Tupu called you brother or sister, you were his brother or sister. And so am I. And so are we. Just because he's gone, doesn't mean that we won't be there for each other for all of our lives and our time on this earth. On that last day, we were doing work here in the church. And as usual, Tupu took the kids out to pass out papers, and I took a nap on that bench. He came back, and we were playing and talking. And then we ran to go home. We took our sister Amber, and we had our brother Tadeni, because Tupu wanted to play basketball with him later that evening. I remember getting into the car, and I remember singing with him, because we did it. We like Pesaroku because of our Mekokisintan, the old Methodist and Rokoeki songs. And so when we play that, everybody else falls asleep because they don't like it. But we like to sing, and we sing together. And I was singing with him when I fell asleep. Up, and my sister was holding him in the front. I came to him, and I said, Tupu, if you can hear me, squeeze my hand. Grab his hand, and he squeezed. Then I let go. And I think back to that day. And I say, Lord, why have you saved me again? I should have gone first 2 times now. Went to the hospital, and I didn't want to believe it until I saw his body. And the first thing I could think of is, how did this guy get so big? I always saw him as my little brother, my gift from God. then I realized that his feet always hang off the bed also, because his feet were hanging off the gurney and so big. A verse that I always shared with him, because I was trying to prepare him for a life without me. And instead, the Lord has prepared me for a life without him. And I said, always say to him, you know, the book of James tells us that your life is a vapor. And it comes and it goes. Don't make plans for tomorrow. Say only if the Lord wills, then we will.
Amen.
And Tupu was ready. Tupu was always ready. He was ready to fight at any time. And he was ready to go. And I don't know how the hospital mixed up our identity. But on his hand that I held, his name tag, it said Enoch Adams Tuaumu-Vaili. I have nothing but the hope in God that I have.
Amen.
And I'm going to keep on coming to church. If only because I want to see him again.
Amen.
And every Sabbath when I come home tired from the work of the Lord that we've done, at 8:42 I will look to his bed and feel the pain in my heart and know that the Lord is coming soon. And I will hold fast because I love to fool. I'm going to call up my sisters. Don't cry.
Before I sing the song, when every person was here for the meeting, this was a love song that me too was even saying when we had a jam session before the meeting started. So I wanted to sing this for him.
Why should I feel
Every day when I arrive home, my son talk to me all and everything. Also, I'm not allowed to tell my father. My mother and I. Also, my son will tell me what I'm talking about. And then he talk about sports. And all the players, you can name all the players of any sports. He knows things. He knows all the players. So he just tell me all I say is, oh, okay, I don't even know a thing. Everybody will go out for me. He's still in my because when we talk, he talked to me as a friend, not as a father. But there are no way to tell me I was in the world. I know something. Because I want to open this conversation with my son, my not my son. So, one day when we were driving, I told my son, I am so excited about your graduation. I'm so excited, son. I'm going to graduate from UC Berkeley. I am so meeker. Because I've got a tour. Well, I was telling him, I'm going to take you to the most expensive restaurant in the area. I'm going to take you there. When you graduate, go to law school, I'm going to take you to the most expensive restaurant in the area. So he was waiting, okay, which one, where? I'm going to take you to hometown. So, Oh, Father, I tell you, I just want to give thanks to all of you for your kindly helping us during this time. Father, I want to pray for you, Father, I'm sharing, Father. And one day when Pastor Yukapuni and Pastor Manuel came, and they came every day, single day since this happened, I told Pastor, sorry, Pastor. Papa, yeah, I told you. Why would I go to the floor? I'm going to stay home for some time. I cannot take this. Tui nā tu atoi whātu mai roto ne rigi mo nā roi. Ei rigi māro roi kise au. Tua, tua. Nō na mona ere mai mai o tā mā. E nēn sa sting sa te iatu te te au. Sa te iatu o tā mā. E nēn sa mā.
I have nothing much to say about this young man. It's just that I miss him every time I come home. I expected everything that I told him to be done. He says, how was work? He says, work was work. Did you wash the dishes? I said, well, of course, Mom. I said, did you do the laundry? Of course. I said, yeah, but did you dry and fold it? Not yet. But I, in a tomb, Lusso wrote him some, and he blessed us with this. And it was a joy to have him for 22 years. Although this relationship is parents and children, it's so hard to take when you miss, especially your baby. I'm looking forward to that day when I shall see him again. My challenge to you, parents, do everything that you can do for your children, even if they're bad. And he was a bad boy too. Love them. Love them like no other. Love them to the Lord. Show them that genuine love that God loved you first and me, you are also able to give them. And for you young people, love the Lord and respect your parents, my brother. Because things like this would happen in times like today. Well, thank God for that hope. But I now laina, sinam tuaya, so the nofi tuaumu-vaili, ele imako. All this grandmother of his loved to spoil him. She loved to spoil him. O te lo le lei la mai la fo mai lo le tu pe lo tu me sa mo e mo 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 la se ku pe nan ka mane e fa sei na ye le te ni na ma fa ye o na fa ye ta tu se me ta sa me ta sa me ti na tu fa sei mo ai no o ma la le tu ai no o mai lo fa sei mo lo tu a sa sa pa ye mo lo tu fa ma fa fa e mo lo tu fa sa si mo la mo na e
in the day of the day, this year. I was to go to San Francisco. I abandoned him when I was to visit.
She is doing what she always has done for us, and especially for the baby, fixing all his food. Lily would work until like 2 in the morning, and if Tupu wanted pancakes and had to be at the bus stop at 6 in the morning, she would still stay up and make his pancakes. So we thank God that my sister loved him that much, because I didn't. Not enough to get up that early and make you some pancakes. So our sister is currently pouring her love into making the food downstairs for her baby. When you pass by her with family, rain a little love down on her too, since she can't be up here to enjoy the services. I just want to give a little time to our younger sister to get a chance yesterday. Before I do go, we do have the blessing of having our grandmother here, and I wanted to share one of Tatupu's favorite stories of him and Tina. After sending him to go with our father to pick him up from the airport, he came back cracking up laughing. And I was like, you need to teach me how to speak Samoan better. I was like, why, what happened? He goes, well, I went to go pick up grandma. I said, and? He goes, and I went to the game. I said, yes. And grandma didn't want them to touch her wheelchair. She said, no, my granddaughter. So I'm looking around thinking, you had me. And I'm thinking, you coming up somewhere. Apparently, I'm the granddaughter. So we need to work out some kind of communication, some hand signals or something, to let grandma know that not cool. Because like, I got a reputation with the ladies. Yeah. I got the real ladies for you. I was like, your grandma is the only lady you need in your life right now. But we can give a little pie to our little sister so she can share a word.
Hi everyone, I'm Amber, and I'm Tupu's cousin on his dad's side, and I consider Tupu my brother. When I first came to the church, he brought me in as his sister. I didn't really have a brother figure in my life growing up. And he took me under his wing as his own little sister, as if I was his blood. And he was always there for me, no matter what. No matter what I put him through, he stuck by my side. And I thank God for blessing me with him. And I know if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't know the things that I know now, and I wouldn't be the person I am today if it wasn't for him being a part of my life. If he was here, he would call me his big cry baby. I miss him so much, but I know that when that glorious day comes, when Jesus comes back to take all of us, I know I'll be one with my brother. I just thank all of you guys for coming, and I thank you for loving my brother.
my job as the oldest sister very seriously. My mother is a very serious character, in case you haven't noticed. Her eyebrows don't play, honey. When she's right in the other direction, she means business. She always told me, God doesn't make mistakes, and God is a God of order. So since I got the lucky chance of being born first, though my daddy said he wished I was a boy. They made sure to instill in me every day that my job was to protect my siblings. That was a thought on my mind when the accident happened. I had been up the whole night before working on flyers for the evangelistic series, and Tupu was the only one who hadn't been up all night. And true to what my brother testified, when my brother was first diagnosed with his cancer when he was 19 years old, through the years, oftentimes I would ask God, like, really? Really, Lord? And he would say, do you trust me? I was like, yeah, I trust you, God. I was like, all right, you put your faith in me. And then when mom was diagnosed with stomach cancer, once again said, excuse me, Lord. I'm not sure of you. I know I hate to bother you with wars and famine and all that stuff going on, but are you sure this is what's meant to happen this way? And once again, he said the same thing. Do you trust me? And when the impact of the car woke me up, then the first thing in my mind was to get out the babies. The children, the youngest ones, Amber and Colin. Man, I got out Steven. And I opened the door and saw Tupu. Again, I said, Lord, I'm not sure who you think I am, but I know I'm not ready. And again, he said, do you trust me?
Yeah, Mommy.
Being the oldest sister, a lot of our younger siblings that we've acquired through Tatupu, and I've told everyone this, Tatupu was the best of our family. He was the kindest, the happiest, the sweetest, the nicest. I looked at Stephen and I started crying while we were sitting on Tupu's bed. He said, you miss Tupu? I said, no, I just realized we're stuck with each other again. Like, Tupu was the nice one. Everybody liked Tupu. Gabe and I had a joke that everybody comes to Tupu, and then I chase them all away. I know a lot to my youth family, especially the younger ones. You've asked why. I'm not going to lie to you. I don't know. But I do know God is God. And at all times we will trust God. More than that, we will praise God. Because for 22 years, we had a good run of family. It wasn't the smoothest of runs. I took him, had me twisted running after him all those times. I mean, I'm not exactly thin. But I want to give a promise of the word. It says, has God forgotten to be gracious? Hath he in anger shut up his tender mercies? Later on in that same chapter, it says, thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God?
Amen.
The night after it happened, we still came back to church the next day, And some people were like, why? Why did you come? Because we find God here. Tupu found God here. And the police officers told us, we don't know how all four of you walked away. Like, how did you just walk away? Nothing's wrong with you. And I have told everyone who's asked me, Tatupu was the only one in that car that was probably ready to go. So to wrap it up, family, I just want, I don't have the words. I want to give you the word this morning that's given me comfort. 1 Corinthians 4, or rather 2 Corinthians, sorry, 4 verse 8 to the end says, we are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in each of you. It is written, I believe, therefore I have spoken. Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak. Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is so, so temporary, but what is unseen, family, is eternal. I hope these words have comforted you as they have comforted me. And to close, we are a trio usually, but we down for the count today. So I'm going to ask my youth choir family to come up here and help me sing a tribute song to our little brother. One of his favorite gospel songs. Coincidentally, another one of our brothers is also resting, Jeff, had the same favorite. And while we know he's resting, one day he will be going up yonder. I hope you prepare yourself to do the same, family.
If you want to know where I'm going, soon, if anybody asks you, where I'm going,
game that we're playing. It's very much for you. Pastor that you love for. He's the secretary of our Samoan Association here in the United States. He is the pastor of Compton Samoan Seventh-day Adventist Church. It is my privilege to introduce to you and welcome him to be our speaker this morning. I already announced last night our speaker, Fred Foyola, because I knew that he used to preach a very short sermon. But last night, it was my mistake. So, I know that Pastor Liu is hearing me crystal clear. I don't want to make the same mistake. Pastor Liu, it's always my pleasure to see you from this church.
Yes, amen.
Once again, welcome.
You know, I have some church members from our church that are here.
Amen.
They will tell you that I don't preach short sermons. But today I will do my best to be obedient to the director of this, or the official, officiating minister of the ceremony, the service. I'll be preaching from Psalms 22, verse 1 and 2. Lower to why? Share in me where to love what my yate. The town of Mao Fao Tang. Oh, before you, oh, Fata Yon. Lower to why? What about how we have to go in the hour? I today far from my mind. I told for him, Ole, my beloved. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear me. And in the night season, and I'm not silent. Part of our message this morning is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Please pray with me. Father God, we ask that you will speak to us now. Allow your spirit to permeate this place and find a place in the hearts of each and every one of us on this day. We pray for the comforting of your Holy Spirit. And we pray that you will send the angels to surround this place so that when your word goes out, it will not return to you void. If there are things that get in the way of hearing of thy word, we pray, Father God, that you will remove these encumbrances and allow us to hear your word with clarity and conviction. This is our prayer. Let all the saints say, Amen. Aside from suicide, death always serves as a reminder that we don't have control of our days on the earth. 22. I was 22 nearly 28 years ago. And at 22, I hadn't accomplished much in life. By the standards that measure success, I was far from succeeding in life. I was closer to destruction than accomplishments. Tupu had completed more by the age of 22 than I did by the age of 30. And it's almost unfair that I lived through my 20s as a terrible human being, not as a bad Christian, but as a terrible human being. And Tupu only lived 2 years into his 20s. Now, I've heard the testimonies. I'm sure that Tupu was a clown like any other kid. But I'm almost certain that Tupu wasn't doing anything illegal or illicit. You know, the loss that's being experienced by the Vaili family has a ripple effect. That effect not only affects the family, but this church as well. You know, as a pastor, we always enjoy when we come into the church or we're part of a church where there are talented young people. Tupu went to sleep with all of his gifts and all of his talents. You know, life is so unfair in so many ways. Why are my boys still alive at 26 and 23, while this young man's life comes to a horrible end? And if God is in control, how do we explain this? The fact that we say God is in control brings us to the place where we say that it must be God's will. Everyone has what you would call a faith narrative. Everyone has a faith narrative that allows them to have this belief in God. And this gives the idea of the kind of God that they associate with. God has many names in the Bible. And there's not one name that encapsulates all of the characteristics of God. There's not enough words. He's Jehovah Rapha. He's our healer. But my wife has been on dialysis since 1987. Healing has eluded her. And it's not fair that my wife is chronically sick while someone else's wife is healthy. Someone here has been waiting for God to cure them of their gouts. Praying to God, God, get rid of my gout. But you know, you probably brought the gout upon yourself. God is Jehovah Jireh, our provider. But yet there are so many people in this world who are homeless and go to bed hungry every single night. He's Jehovah Rohi, our shepherd, who leads us, but many people are lost and have no direction in their lives. He's Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace. But yet this world is in constant turmoil and upheaval. Homes have no peace. Nations are constantly at war. Their peace eludes them. And even the churches are devoid of peace. Amen.
He is Jehovah Shammah, the ever-present God, but yet we feel so alone at a time when we need his presence most, like these moments. My God, why have you forsaken me? I'm not here to discuss the Odyssey. I'm not here to discuss why God permits evil, why tragic events like this happen. My responsibility is to give you an understanding that might help repair the damaged relationships that now exist between man and God because of tragedies like this. This is the type of thing that happens when we feel as if God doesn't hear us. The preacher last night said sometimes there's some questions that don't have answers. And I concur and I agree. David said in the same chapter, I am but a worm. A worm can't understand anything that I do as a human being. So what makes us think that we can understand what God does? And when you think about it, what has shaped and strengthened us as human beings weren't the answers to life, but it was the problems of life that have made us tough. You know, I'm happy to be kept in the dark about some things. Because God, if God revealed everything about my life to me, my life would be miserable. I would worry about what kind of man, you know, my daughter turns 19 on Wednesday. I would worry as a father, what kind of man is my daughter going to marry? Will he be kind to her or will he beat her? Will he be faithful or will he think he's some sort of hit dad? Will my kids stay in the church or will they leave, end up leaving the church like their dad did when I was their age? You know, I shared this with my wife. And I said, if God would have shown me 28 years ago your condition now, do you think that as a 22-year-old that I would say that I would stay with you? I'm just thinking as a 22-year-old. That's me. As a 22-year-old, I ain't got time for all that. But as somebody who's more mature, when God reveals it to me, I say, Lord, I'm the best man to take care of that one. Yeah. It's not always good to know what the future holds. You know, most biblically literate people know the title of today's message comes from the time of Jesus. Jesus was reciting the words found in this song, written by David hundreds of years earlier. There's this idea that I've heard. There's this idea that we shouldn't question God. My response is, why not? Why can't we question God? Did not Jesus himself question God on the cross? My God, why have you forsaken me? You know the prayers of Jesus. He uses the Father more than 70 times. He doesn't use Father in the prayer on the cross. But he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? The prayer on the cross was a prayer of somebody in pain. Anguished cries of a dying man screaming up to heaven, my God. Why have you forsaken me? That way to Rafa my yet. You see, Jesus in his humanity, Jesus can feel the sting of impending death. And the pain of separation and loneliness. So he utters these words penned by David in Psalm 22. My God. my God, why have you forsaken me? You know, when this tragedy occurred, I woke up Sunday morning and my daughter said, Dad, did you hear about something? I said, I fell asleep. I just heard the prayer request. I prayed that night. I said, Lord, please. You know where the need is right now. Please, dear God, answer the prayers. Because I'm a father. And to think and believe that something like this could happen to my sons, or my child, that's faint up. But I sensed a deep cry for help in Florencia's plea while Tupu was still being attended to at the hospital. The cry for help rang loud and clear on Facebook, and hundreds of prayers were sent heavenward at that moment. But here we are. My God, why have you forsaken me? Did God hear our prayers? I mean, did God not hear our prayers? You know, it's said that prayer changes things. I'm not going to dispute that. I'm not going to dispute that, but let me give you a different perspective out of my own experience. Many people have been praying for my wife's health, and no one has been praying more than me and my wife. But her condition has gotten worse. Prayer hasn't changed her circumstance, despite several years of prayer. But I'll tell you what has changed. Prayer has changed me and my wife. So although prayer hasn't changed our circumstance, it has matured her faith, and it's been the place and time where we can be brutally honest with God. And although her circumstance hasn't changed for the better, prayer has changed us until things change for the better. And in God's time, it will change. And we're okay with waiting. We're okay with waiting. You see, we can't hurt God's feelings with our prayers. Prayer is a time where we can be brutally honest with God. Psalm 62, verse 8. It says, trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. You see, the human side of Jesus says, Father, if it be thy will, please take this cup from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Job said in the Message Bible, she said, this is Job, I mean, just really being honest with God. Job said, I can't stand my life. I hate it. I'm putting it all out on the table, all bitterness of my life. I'm holding back nothing. Jeremiah said, why this chronic pain, this ever-worsening wound, and no healing in sight? You're nothing, God, but a mirage of lovely oasis in the distance, and then nothing. These are Bible characters. Why do we as human beings insist that we have to be hardcore and portray some sort of super saint facade? God can handle our grief towards him. God is not a man that he would have self-esteem issues when we complain. We can vent and express our hurt. My God, why have you forsaken me? You see, our honesty with God in prayer also says something about our relationship with God. Here's what I mean. When we pour out our hearts and have these prayer sessions with God, it's an indication that you have faith and belief in God. Yeah. Because atheists and non-believers can't pour out their hearts and have open conversations with anyone because there's no God to believe in.
That's right.
Are you getting this? Yes. So that's why it's okay for you to question this. God's a big boy. He can handle himself. Amen. He doesn't have self-esteem issues like some people tell us. I need to talk to you about something. And they tell us, man, we'd be hurt for years. God's not like that. God's not a man. Christians, on the other hand, every opportunity to vent to an almighty God because we believe. Oh, you know what? Pastor, is he here? I'm getting ready to wrap this up. Okay? Before entering ministry, I spent several years in a mental health field. And I gained firsthand experience about anger, depression, loneliness, and what happens when people don't talk about their issues. And I learned that it was always easier to help someone who's willing to talk about it and what's going on in their life compared to someone who just holds it in. You know, one time I went to do a visit with a kid. So my time with the kid is 1 hour. I did that old Goodwill Hunting kid. I said, okay, well, since my time before you is 1 hour, I'm going to sit here and watch you for 1 hour. That's all I did. He didn't want to talk. He didn't want to do nothing. He fell asleep on the dining table. But I did that every week till eventually the kid talked to me. And we were able to find out what the issues are in life. That's why, friend, the 18, the Tatupu Tuaumu-Vaili, if I know how to get to Tatupu. And I learned that when we talk about it, we end up working it out. And whether it be issues surrounding Tupu's passing or your own personal issues, God sits on his throne and he's awaiting our pleas and our concern. Christ said, come to me, all of you who are heavy with burdens, and I'll give you rest. In 1991, I spent a few days at the Santa Rita Resort, run by the Alameda County Sheriff's Department. Nothing serious. Couple of people here. If it was serious, I would pass background and I wouldn't be up here preaching. But I was there on an all-expense-paid weekend. And at that time, my girlfriend, who is now my wife, came to visit me. One child in tow, and another one in the oven. And it was a Saturday, and I get a call. Lafo, you have a visit. So I get ready and put on my best outfit. You guys know, you only get one outfit. Now we know which side went to jail. So I'm getting ready to go and do my visit. I asked one of the brothers in there to braid my tail. You know, that's in the 90s. You used to have the flat top and the long hair in the back. You know, Jerry Curl. You know what I'm talking about. The messengers had everybody in the messengers. She and Oka had a Jerry Curl too back then. But I had this brother just ask, hey man, can you braid my hair? I said, yeah, okay. Got myself looking pretty for the visit. And you know when you're in jail, you have to be tough, or at least look tough, so that the other inmates don't try to poke you. I know it's hard to believe, but I strolled over to the visiting area in my jail sandals, trying to sag my county issue carry pants, just trying to be as hard as I could possibly be. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you were better at it than I was. Anyways, the visits were what you call non-contact visits. It wasn't behind a glass window, it was across from a table. So I sit down and my wife is across from me, Alan is across from me, and she has my son on her lap. The visit's going pretty good for the first few minutes until my son starts getting fidgety. And he starts to reach out. But there's a table between me and my wife and him. The rules say you can't touch the inmates. And as much as I wanted to reach over and touch my son and grab him and hold him, the rules forbid me from reaching over. So here's my son, Daddy, and he's trying to claw over the table or fall down or crawl under the table. But he wanted his daddy, and his daddy wanted his son. And it breaks my heart because I wanted to hold him so bad. And just watching him try to claw over the table was enough to bring someone who thought he was tough, bring him to tears, and my eyes started to water, and I'd say, you know, let's cut this visit short. I think you need to go. Because the last thing I wanted to do is have somebody see me crying in jail. But oh, how I longed to snatch up my son and pull him close to my bosom. But there was something in the way. Enoka, Tawa, Florencia, and Stephen, I know this loss is heartbreaking, and you wish you could just reach into the casket and just hold your baby one more time, like you used to. But death is in the way. And although you have 22 years of memory, the truth is you can't hug memories, you can't kiss memories, you can't have dinner with memories. But it is my sincere prayer that the memories of your son and the promises of God can sustain you until that day. Yeah. That day when God wipes away every tear of sorrow and replaces it with tears of joy and jubilation. Yes. One day, we will be in that place where it's said that there will be no more weeping, no more crying, no sick and wounded, no hunger and hurting. And you can walk from one side of the city to the other side of the city. You will not see a cemetery in there. Amen. Because God has gotten rid of death. And on that great day, we will come to realize that despite all of our earthly anguish and suffering, that God never forsakes us. Amen. Isso foi Jesus. Amen.
For the encouraging message, you know that you are a little bit better than Phil. Amen. Father, we pray this. We are calling the room on the panel. I'll be talking here. The push of Tatupu. This is for the immediate family only. Before the casket is closed. So after when you close the casket, and then Pastor Hudson will close in our benediction.
Cemetery. The address is 1370 El Camino Rio.
Precious in your sight are the saints that die in you.
So now we celebrate the life of our dear brother. And now we recognize in the human sense that we must leave it to Jehovah Jireh, the God who will see to it. Lord, see to it that on that day when you come back the second time, there's a shout and the trump of God sounds, and the cloud will be seen off of the earth. You tell your angels, go get my sons and my daughters. Lord, see to it. My dear Anthony's grave will be part of the dead in Christ that arises. Then we which are alive and left shall be caught up together in the air. Lord, see to it. The family and those that are listening in the sound of my voice, recognize that the greatest thing we can do now is to live in such a way that we'll be ready when the Jehovah Jireh, the God who will see to it, shall put to end death, and shall be no more tears, no more crying, and no more pain. So Lord, we thank you for your promises. Thank you for your love. We thank you for your commitment to us that you see to it. Now, family, may the Lord bless thee and keep thee. May the Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Christ saves.